Hello and welcome to this series of video tutorials about making HTML5 games. Now, as this is the first in the series, we're going to start with a very basic question. What is an HTML5 game? HTML, as I'm sure you already know, is the standard used to define web pages, and it's now in its fifth iteration. Now, version 5 is really quite special. It's got some new elements that allow you to do some really complex stuff, such as making applications and, of course, games. The main difference between the previous versions is the canvas, which, like the name implies, is a rectangle on screen onto which you can draw anything you like. So how do you draw onto this canvas? Well, you would do it using JavaScript, which is a popular and powerful scripting language which is interpreted by web browsers. Don't worry if you don't know too much about JavaScript at this point. As long as you know some basic principles, you're going to be fine. Now, to make things easier, we are going to use a game engine that takes care of all the complicated stuff, allowing us to concentrate on the game that we're trying to make. There are a lot of free engines out there in order to do this. We're going to use Clockwork Chili's WADE. Now, full disclaimer, I work for Clockwork Chili. WADE is an acronym that stands for Web App Development Engine. It's a free engine and allows you to write your code once and use it without modification on a variety of devices such as PCs and mobile phones. So let's go to www.clockworkchili.com and then click here where it says Developers. Now we want to log in or create a free account if you don't have one. It'll only take a few seconds. And then click here where it says Downloads. Now we want to download the latest version of WADE, 0.8 in this case. It's a zip file, and if we open it, there are some files inside. I'm going to create a folder on the desktop, which I'm going to call Awesome Game. And I'm going to put all those files in there. Now, since JavaScript is an interpreted language, you don't need a compiler to compile your game. You could code it in Notepad or any text editor, and then the browser would execute it. However, as your project becomes a bit more complex, you'll probably need a better development environment to handle all your code files. There are many alternatives, some of them are even free. If you're looking for a free one, Eclipse is quite good. Personally, however, I would recommend WebStorm, which is free for 1 month, and then it's still quite cheap. Just give the free trial a go, and then you can decide whether or not it's worth your money. When you open WebStorm for the first time, it will ask you how you want to create a project. We don't want to import any settings, and we want to use the evaluation version. So, let's select Open Directory, and let's browse to our Awesome Game folder. It will also want to access the internet, which is okay. Now, here on the left-hand side, we have a list of all the files that we have in our folder. There is an extra setup step that we need to perform, depending on which browser we're going to use. HTML5 apps work on all browsers, but for the development process, I recommend using Chrome, which is a little bit easier. So if you don't have it, download it and install it. Once you have it, let's browse to the location of the Chrome executable. On a 64-bit Windows machine, this is going to be C, Program Files, x86. Google Chrome application. Drag chrome.exe onto the desktop to create a shortcut and edit its properties. You're going to add an extra command line parameter, dash dash allow file access from files with words separated by dashes. We need this because our app is now located on the hard drive and Chrome doesn't allow scripts on your hard drive to run unless you tell it it's okay. So if we now run Chrome through this shortcut, this particular Chrome window will be able to run local scripts. Let's try this by opening our Awesome Game folder and dragging the index.html file onto this Chrome window. We get a nice blank page, which is correct because we haven't started writing our app yet. Okay, now back to WebStorm and our list of files. The only one we care about at the moment is this index.html file. If we open it, we can see that there's quite a lot going on here, but we don't care about any of this stuff except for this one grey line. It's grey because it's commented out, as you can see with this double slash. Let's uncomment it. This is telling WADE to initialize our app, which is in a file called test.js. Now, test.js doesn't even exist at the moment, and we can replace this with our own name. So let's call it awesome.js. Okay, now we have to create this awesome.js file. I'm right-clicking here on Awesome Game. Then I select New JavaScript File and call it Awesome. Now we have a blank JavaScript file where we can finally start creating our Wade app. So what is a Wade app then? It's simply a function called app, capital A. It's important because JavaScript is case sensitive. Now let's save that and go back to Chrome and refresh. It's still a blank page because although we have created an app, the app is still doing nothing. But we're going to change that now. Inside the app function, we create two more functions called load and init, like this. Okay, so creating functions inside a function might seem a little bit confusing if you're not used to JavaScript. One thing that you need to remember is that functions in JavaScript are objects. So app is an object and all we're really doing is adding a few properties to this object. These properties are called load and init and they're both functions. They're automatically called by Wade. So Wade calls load first, and that's where you load all your images, your sounds, and so on. And when it's finished loading, Wade will automatically call init. So first of all, we need an image to load. Now I've downloaded an image of a cute molehead from the internet. I've called it mole.png, and I'm putting it in our awesome game folder. So if I go back to our app file, and in the load function, I write Wade load image mole.png. Now, let's use this image. In the init function, I'm going to create a sprite, like this, that uses the mole.png image. Sprite here is a local variable, and that's what var means. And now we have to display this image on the screen. In Wade, there is a scene, or a game world if you like. We need to create a scene object to add to the scene. A scene object is an object that contains one or more sprites that can then be moved around the scene. Let's create one, like this. I'm calling it mole, and I'm telling it to use our sprite. Now, let's tell Wade to add it to the scene. Wade, add scene object, mole. That's it. Now we can save, go back to Chrome, refresh, and there it is on the screen. Now that's a good start, but we also want a hole where this mole is supposed to be hiding. It's exactly the same process. I've got this hole.png image and I copy it to my games folder. Then I load it in the load function and I create a new sprite for the hole, calling it hole sprite, very original name. And I create a new scene object called hole, which I then add to the scene. Okay, so let's see what happens if I save and go back to Chrome. The hole's right there, but the mole's disappeared. That's because the hole is in front of the mole, so we need to address this problem. When you create a sprite, you tell it which image you're going to use. But you could also use an extra parameter to say on which layer it has to appear. So for example, I could set the mole object to be on layer 10 and the hole object to be in layer 20. Now layers with lower numbers appear in front of layers with higher numbers, so that means that the mole will be in front of the hole. So let's try that. Save. Go to Chrome and refresh, and there it is. Okay, so that's better, but it's still not quite what we wanted. You see, we want the mole to come out of the hole. Now, in order to do this, I'm going to use a trick. I'm going to split the whole picture into two parts. The bottom part will be in front of the mole, and the top part will be behind it. So, I had already prepared these pictures, and now I'm copying them to my game folder. In the app file, I load these two new pictures in the load function. I'm removing the previous whole picture as well. In the init function, I now create two sprites, whole top and whole bottom. I want them to be on two different layers now. Whole top would be on layer 20 and whole bottom can be in front of everything else, say layer 5. I still want one single scene object called whole, but now this scene object will be made up of two sprites. How do we do that? We just use an array of sprites like this when creating a scene object. As you can see, the layer number is the property of sprites, not scene objects. A scene object can be made by one sprite, like this mole object up here, or two sprites, like our whole object down here, or any number of sprites, really. Okay, so save, back to Chrome, see what it's looking like. It's a bit of a mess at the moment because everything's exactly on top of each other, so let's move things around a bit. The whole object is made of two sprites. Now we want these sprites to be in different positions. In fact, we want each of them to have an offset relative to the position of the whole object. Since I haven't specified a size for the sprites, they'll be the same size of the source image. In this case, they'll both be 128 pixels tall. So I'm going to give the top sprite an offset of 64 along the y-axis. That is, I'm moving it up by half its height. And I do the opposite with the bottom sprite, move it down by 64 units like this, using the set sprite offset function of my scene object. If you're not familiar with JavaScript, this syntax here with the curly braces is used to quickly define an object. In this case, we're passing an object to the setSpriteOffset function, and it's an object with two properties, x that equals 0 and y that equals 64. Okay, so let's see if that looks right now. Yep, it does. You can see that a bit of the head of the mole is coming out while it's partially hidden by the bottom sprite. Okay, so you might be wondering, why have sprites inside scene objects? Why not just add the sprites directly to the scene? Well, this way makes it a lot more convenient. For example, our whole object contains two sprites. This means that if we want to move the whole anywhere on the scene, both sprites will move at the same time. It's quicker, it's easier. There are other advantages as well to this, which you'll see in a minute. Now, this init function is about 10 lines long. There are much more compact ways of doing the same thing with much less typing, in two or three lines, but to keep things clear and understandable here, I am being quite verbose. Since we haven't specified any positions for any object, everything is going to be at the origin, 0, 0. But we want the mole to start a bit lower and then move up. So when we create the mole object, we give it a position, like this. Mole set position 0, 50. We also tell it to move up towards the coordinates, 0, minus 40, with a speed of 100 units per second. Let's go back to Chrome once again. There it is. It's hidden, and then it's coming out. It's pretty cool. We want to make it go up and down continuously now. So as soon as it's finished going up, we want it to go back down. We can add a new property to our mole object. Let's say it can have a state, and this state can be up or down. It starts being down. Then when it's finished moving up, its state changes to up. It's easy to do this because when the mole is finished moving, Wade will fire an event called onMoveComplete. We can do something when this event happens like this. Mole object onMoveComplete equals function. And in here we decide what happens every time the mole finishes moving. So if the state was down, now it's going to be up. And if it was up, now it's going to be down. And also, if the state is now up, let's start moving down and vice versa, still using the moveTo function. If we open it in Chrome, now it's moving up and down continuously. Now this is pretty cool, but we want to make the whole thing a little bit more interactive. Let's say that we have a score, and it's initially 0. Every time we click on the mole, we get 1 point. If we click on the hole, we lose 1 point. So first of all, we want a variable to keep track of our score. So var score equals 0. We then create a text sprite. It's just like a normal sprite, but instead of using images, it displays text. This text initially will be our score. Var score text equals new text sprite score to string. And also one more parameter, which is the font we want to use, say 36 pixel Arial. And we also need a scene object to add the text to the scene. We put it somewhere on the top, say at 0 minus 150, and Wade, add scene object, score object. Okay, let's take a quick look. That's looking good enough. Let's make it even better though by making it red. and also center aligned. Okay, that's better. Now let's make it actually work. Okay, so we want to define what happens when someone clicks on the mole object. So let's do this. Mole on mouse down equals function. And in here, we say what happens, which is pretty simple, increment the score. And we also update the score text set text score. Since this is an input event, unlike on move complete, we'll have to tell Wade that our mole object is listening to this mouse down event, like this. Wade, add event listener, mole object on mouse down. And let's try this immediately. Okay, so when I click the mole, I get 1 point, and when I click elsewhere, nothing happens. And what happens when I click down here when the mole is hiding? Well, I still get a point, and I shouldn't. This is because the whole object is not getting the input event, the mole's getting it, so we need to change that now. Whole on mouse down equals function, score minus minus, score text set text score, Wade add event listener, whole on mouse down. It's exactly the same thing that I did above. Let's try it. Okay, so this isn't quite right. Now when I click on the mole, nothing happens. And when I click elsewhere, I lose a point. Now let me explain what's happening here. If you click on an object, its onMouseDown function will be called if the object is listening for the onMouseDown event. If you click somewhere where there are multiple objects listening for the onMouseDown event, the object at the very top will be called first, followed by all of the objects below. The onMouseDown event propagates to all of the objects below in order. Now to stop this propagation is to return true in your onMouseDown functions like this. Now let's try this again. And there we go, it's working properly. 1 point for hitting the mole, minus 1 point for missing it. Okay, you may be thinking, wait a minute, we're reacting to mouse down events. What happens if the user doesn't have a mouse? Didn't we say the game would work without modifications on phones or tablets? Well, yes they do, because Wade does some clever input mapping, so you don't need to be worried about whether or not your user has or hasn't got a touchscreen device. You can run the game as it is on a touchscreen device and it will just work. The onMouseDown function will be called whenever the user touches the screen. So, it's a pretty basic game, but it's a start. We'll be making it more interesting in our next tutorial, where we'll be introducing the concept of behaviours. I hope this helped you get started with HTML5 and Wade. More video tutorials are coming soon, but in the meantime, on Clark Ritchie's website in the Developers section, there are many written resources and tutorials for you to have a look at. Thanks for watching and goodbye.